Hello and welcome to QUEERSAY. I'm Andrew Kay. My guest is Geoffrey Bowden. Hello, Geoffrey.
Hello.
You're not late today.
No, I'm absolutely bang on time.
Oh, marvellous, isn't it? You haven't changed your shirt and nor have I. Work it out for yourselves if you're viewing.
Right.
Let's get straight on. A YouTube musician is called Gays and Abomination and celebrates the Pulse shootings. These were the shootings last year in Orlando where 49 guys were killed.
Murdered,
yes.
Yes, but this guy is full of hate because he doesn't like women either.
No, he doesn't like anyone, I don't think.
And I suspect he doesn't like himself very much either. And this is probably why he crams his YouTube channel with such hate-filled rubbish.
Does hate crime exist in American legislation in the same way that we have?
I don't know, but this
is
Australia.
This guy's
Australia.
Yeah.
He's
quite happy to make money.
Yeah.
Out of his music from gay men.
Well,
and women.
It very possibly, but I don't think it's gay people downloading his brand of hate. And if he is making money out of it, it only goes to show that there are a lot of people out there who feel similarly to him. So, you know, there are...
It's a worry, isn't it?
It is a worry.
It's a worry.
So, you know, equality is kind of just skin deep quite often, and you only have to have something coming from an influencer, and I guess this guy can be classified as someone who can influence young people, or a senior politician, like a president. And that kind of message and that kind of aura trickles down and it finds an audience. So, you know, in the other edition, we were talking about murders in the south of transgender people, which seemed to go uninvestigated and unsolved. Here we have someone in Australia whose life mission is to be vile to homosexuals. But he is misogynistic as well. So who does he like? You know, he doesn't like women, he doesn't like gays, and I guarantee he doesn't like himself very much.
No, I think there is a lot of self-hate in this sort of area. And I just worry that perhaps we don't make a strong enough backlash. I was looking this morning and a good friend, sent me over 200... pieces of trolling that she'd had since being at an event last week.
Yeah.
And I think actually we need to sort of troll back and start actually fighting back these people.
Well, it's difficult.
It's great because,
you know,
but
if we speak to our religious friend who comes on this program, he would probably advise turn the other cheek. And I'd rather not fight fire with fire, but you have to talk to our friend Sophie Cook. Ask to look at her inbox.
Well, that's to who see, I was talking about.
To see how much
shocking
trolling and transphobia that she has to put up with. And you have to be a strong person to withstand all that. And we know that some people, they're not that strong, and sometimes they, you know, decide to take their own lives as a result of this kind of, bullying.
Well, I think one of the responses that was sent was a strong statement here, and it said, "Good luck selling your music without the queer community. It's 2018. Wake up, asshole."
Yeah.
And I think perhaps that sort of response might be good.
Yeah, but you would think that if his main channel is YouTube, you'd think that YouTube could be persuaded to block...
Take him down.
...block this stuff, because it's inciting...
Yes.
He's inciting violence towards millions of people.
And hate and violence. And I think YouTube does have to accept that it has a responsibility here.
Well, I think a lot of the social media channels and outlets like YouTube do have to look at it.
Yes.
That they're taking it seriously now in terms of material that could be used by people who are interested in terrorism and, fundamentalists who want to blow people up. This is the same thing, because it's inciting people to murder other human beings.
Absolutely. Let's move on. It doesn't seem to be a week goes by we don't have a story from Russia, but this one is hysterical. A Russian ambassador has said there's no homophobia in Russia. Putin met Elton John.
Yes, it goes. I classify this along with some of my best friends are gay.
It is, certainly, isn't it?
Yes, so...
How long ago was it that Elton John went and met Putin?
Oh, a few years ago now.
It's quite some time, isn't it? Funnily enough, Ambassador, things have changed in Russia.
Well, they have, and but, you know, there is still homophobia, and outwardly so. But I keep thinking back of that the video that went viral with the Aeroflot pilots school.
I told you about this. You must delete it. It's not good for your health, Jeffrey.
It's fantastic. It went viral.
Did more good for that airline than any form of spent advertising
could
have
done. It
did,
but what's more interesting, it prompted other lookalike videos throughout Russia. Yeah. Which shows that there is a sort of a tolerant foundation somewhere within the
Well, it was ridiculous to think that there are no homosexuals in Russia. I mean, they keep on making this. Certainly in Chechnya, they're saying there are no homosexuals here. How can we be oppressing homosexuals in our state? Because there aren't any.
You know, this is kind of...
It's nuts, isn't it?
It is total nuts. And, you know, for people to... make these kind of statements, they're just making themselves looking more and more foolish in the eyes of the world. And frankly, they may want to sweep it aside. You know, I'm talking to you now, and all I can have is an image of Vladimir Putin having pumped up with his shirt off, looking like something out of Spartacus magazine.
Oh, that's going back a little bit, isn't it? I suppose they're still under your mattress, are they?
They're holding up the coffee table.
Yes.
But, you know...
And for those younger viewers, Spartacus was a magazine.
Yes.
Full of art photography.
Exactly.
Art photography, call it that.
You know,
He has got a penchant for riding around on that horse with his shirt off, hasn't he?
Yes.
It looks a bit like a Cadenet movie.
It is.
70s.
Yes, if only I knew who he is.
He's lying. Yeah. I think this whole state of what's happening in Russia is so dangerous at the moment, because the denials are coming fast and furious alongside the stories of oppression, and it needs to be sorted.
Well, frankly, this needs to be responded most vigorously by Elton John. He needs to come up and say, excuse me, I may have met you.
Yes.
But
it's Elton.
Get off.
Elton, leave the kids for a moment.
Exactly.
Get out the paddling pool.
And he's a great advocate. So,
he certainly is. Yeah.
And he calls it out as it is, and I hope he might use this as an excuse to say, excuse me, but you're...
Sort yourself out.
Yeah, exactly.
Let's move on.
Exactly.
This is a very sad story, and this is the UK want to separate two husbands and send one to his death. These are two men... And one of them is fighting a deportation order, taking him back to Nepal, where he faces death threats from people that he once called his family.
Yes, it's extremely sad. But we've talked about this on frequent occasions,
yes,
about how the Home Office is totally dysfunctional. And we've seen it, whether it's Windrush generation, or it's gay couples being split and someone being sent back to...
Do you think the Home Office works under its own steam, or do you think they work under directives from Parliament?
Well, if I tell you that my partner had to seek leave to remain, and it took us a long time, mm-hmm, and a lot of money, and generally speaking, you are dealing with, dare I say it, automatons, who only look at the rules, they don't look at the people. I've got many horrific tales. When I had a life as an elected politician, I was dealing with heartrending cases, and he really wanted to go and shake people up. I was with a chap who I interviewed for this channel, who is an asylum seeker. His interview with the Home Office has been cancelled twice, and they've now set his interview for the day he's doing his exams. and they've given him an hour to get to London after his exams finish. So his head will be full of whatever.
Well, he won't focus on his exams.
No.
Because he'll be worried about the interview.
Yes.
But and he stands a chance of blowing the interview because he's focused on his exams.
Exactly.
That's terrifying.
But, I mean, this is kind of an example of how the Home Office bureaucrats work. And you talk to any of our MPs, and they are... they write to the Home Office about cases. They never hear anything back. I was with Lloyd Russell-Moyle this week.
We're going to have to go to a break, Geoffrey. It's a very big subject. We're going to go to some ads. We'll see you after the break. Maybe we'll come back to it then. Hello and welcome back to QUEERSAY. I'm Andrew Kay and my guest is Geoffrey Bowden. Let's move on, I think, Geoffrey. That story before the break is very, very important.
Yes.
And we'll return to it, I know, repeatedly. And I think we'll return to it an awful lot when Brexit comes into place.
I think so.
Because the number of countries that we will be thinking about deporting people to will expand by all of those in the Union.
We have to take note of what all three of our local MPs say about the Home Office and dealing with them. Because it's outrageous.
Mm.
Anyway.
Let's move on. So, I read this story and I thought, oh, another one from the Deep South. White supremacist escapes jail sentence after being found guilty of planning to attack a Pride event. And then I remembered who it is. And this happened in the Lake District. This is this young guy who threatened the Pride and up in the Lake District and was found guilty. He said... there's a Pride night. I'm going to walk in with a fucking machete and slaughter every single one of them.
Yes.
I don't want to live in a gay world. Sure as hell don't want my children living in one. He was sentenced, and then he sort of said, actually, I think I might be bisexual, which was rather bizarre.
He's been reading too many Jilly Cooper novels.
That's it.
This is it.
That's it. And then he's got a hospital order and he's a mess. But the terrifying thing is that he's escaped.
Well, it is...
He's escaped custody somehow.
Well, it's odd.
So what level of security are they wrapping around someone who has threatened to walk into a crowd with a machete and slaughter people? He used the word slaughter himself.
Well, anyone who remembers a nail bomb tossed into a bar in Soho, we'll know this is not a sort of threat that should be taken idly.
No.
I had friends who lost limbs in that attack.
Yes, me too.
And there are people out there who are egged on. We talked about YouTube channels earlier, and they see this kind of hate being normalised by influencers such as our YouTuber, such as statements coming out of the White House and so on. All these things, or, you know, the Putin regime saying there are no such things as gays. These things normalise people who are slightly deranged. And then we have a Home Office and a justice system that can't keep tabs on them, even when they've got them banged to rights. You know, I'm sure if he does, they do get him and they throw him behind bars, he'll have a whale of his time.
Well, they didn't put him behind bars. He was actually given an indefinite hospital order, which is normally something that's given to people with extreme mental health issues. But to be able to get out... Oh. I mean, I love what the judge said, because in his... he said that he hadn't revealed his sexuality because he thought his parents would be ashamed of him, and the judge later dismissed his coming out as lies.
Yes.
What do you think he was trying to do at that point in this story, saying, actually, I'm bisexual?
I mean, you know... Maybe
I mean, it's a slur against all bisexuals, apart from anything else.
Well, he was
perhaps
trying to get a lighter sentence... But, you know, sometimes people pray these things in evidence.
But even that
doesn't make
sense,
does it? We think of famous
actors
who are found out and suddenly just, you know, say, you know, I was...
Oh, yes.
We know which actor we're talking about.
Well, my bathrobe just happened to fall open at that moment.
Yes.
We all know who we're talking about.
Exactly.
But I don't understand what he thought saying that he was bisexual would sway in the mind of judge and jury in terms of sentencing? Because, you know, you threaten to slaughter people who are faggots, and then you say, actually, I'm not that bad because I'm actually bisexual myself. Actually, I think that's worse, isn't it?
Well, it is.
Internalised homophobia is possibly one of the worst things that blights our society.
For those people who are armchair psychiatrists like you and myself...
what was he thinking?
He was probably thinking that, you know, this would justify his actions because he was, you know, struggling with his own inner gay self.
Oh.
And therefore he showed it in this odd
place. Bless him, the poor man.
Yes.
The poor man.
But in the meantime...
Get real, mister.
Yeah, but in the meantime, he's out on the run somewhere and he could...
Well, he could do something very radical and awful.
He could.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Awful. I don't think we've got a photograph of him, but I think maybe we should try and pop one up. And if we have one, then if you do see this man, because if he is disturbed and if he is targeting gay men and women, then maybe people should know what he looks like.
Yep.
I think that would be very important. Let's have a look into
that. Can't disagree with that.
Let's move on. Here's a good news story. A vending machine for HIV testing kits wins a national award, and this is coming from Brighton.
Hurrah.
It's a wonderful thing. It's a touchscreen vending machine. You get a self-test kit. At the moment, it's only available in Brighton Sauna, but they're moving on to a second generation of this thing, and they're going to be putting them in a lot more places, and I think this is absolutely fantastic news. And I have to say congratulations to the entire team at the Martin Fisher Foundation who have been behind this project, and in particular to the wonderful Dr. Gillian Dean. It's a fantastic move forward, because I think there is still the stigma of having to go and ask for the test.
Yes, and people who haven't been tested lately and, you know, may have, you know, come from my generation when testing was a very long and...
Slow and very worrying process,
where you had, you know, a long time to wait for results, where all sorts of things could go through your head. Now, to get to a stage where you can actually do something about it and take action quickly, mm-hmm. and get a result quickly, and then know that also, you know, from the tombstone days to now, where people have been living with the condition for years and productive lives, mm-hmm. it is not a death sentence. So this is a really good story, and I'm delighted it should be coming out of Brighton.
Well, it's wonderful. It's not, and it's no small award that this award. It's from the British Medical Journal, 28, and it's an innovation award. There were 3,500 applicants in 15 categories, and they won with this.
Well, I think it's excellent news. I don't know whether they get any dosh for this.
Not sure whether they get any dosh, but what they do say is that it will take us closer, a step closer, to Brighton becoming one of those lead cities where there's no increase in positive diagnosis.
Yes, well, I mean, I think that should be the aim. And, I mean, we have had fluctuations, so... where we've seen decreases, they have gone up and down a bit. But this kind of raises awareness that you should always be safe in your sexual practices. And if there's a degree of uncertainty, then find out.
Absolutely.
Because, you know, you can be looked
after. Finding out is the key.
Yeah.
It really is.
Yeah. And there's
playing safe is a key, finding out is a key.
Yeah, and there's all sorts of support. If you are positive, then, you know, the support networks that are in place to help you through this and live a productive life thereafter are amazing, because in the early days there was absolutely nothing.
Nothing there. Let's move on after that piece of good news. I think this is rather sweet, and this is a... Twin brothers come out to their mother in a sweet YouTube video. Did you watch it?
I haven't seen it yet.
It is very sweet, but it does... I thought it brought out... my word, what sort of world are we in where if you're going to come out, you post something on YouTube?
Yeah, well,
because it's not very personal, is it?
It isn't, but you think Tom Daley did the same thing in his way. But then there was another YouTube video, which was from America, where the guy... filmed what was going on, and the violence, you know, that was visited to this poor guy by his dad. And yes, they were thrown that. Out of the house. So sometimes it can go either way.
Of course it can. And, I mean, I think you and I are probably very aware of the fact that there are still young people who are being thrown out by their families. 2018 and being thrown out by their families. Now, those families will be our age and certainly younger. You would think that people of our generation and the generation coming up to our generation would be far more tolerant and understanding and not be doing this. But so many people end up in our city, particularly, because they see this as the, you know, the crock of gold at the end of the yellow brick road, where being gay is a comfortable thing to be.
Yeah, you know, we are more tolerant, but we still have charities that cater solely to young people who have found themselves in a situation where they are not accepted by their family and they are thrown out. And, you know, the need for those sort of charities, I heard you talk at one of those fundraising dinners about your own experiences. And sadly, that still happens to too many people.
Coming out is a difficult thing to get through, but if anyone does want advice about it, I would say think it through, but do it. Don't sit back. Just get it done. It's really important. We're running out of time, Geoffrey. It's been wonderful having you here again today, and hope you'll be back in a few weeks' time to join me again for another two episodes of QUEERSAY. But for this evening, thank you for watching. We'll see you all again very soon. Good night.